Okay, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
We begin this morning with Sefer Shemos and Parshas Shemos. We are going to be looking at some of the verses in the very first chapter in the book of Exodus. So we know that after listing the names of the tribes that descended down to Egypt, the Torah tells us that things quickly sour in Mitzrayim. We're looking right now at source number one. This is Perek Aleph, Sukim Ches through Yud. Chapter 1, verses 8 through 10. Vayaka melech chadash al Mitzrayim, asher lo yada es Yosef. Over Egypt, who did not know about Joseph, famous comment of Rashi, he literally, or was it the same old king, but this king now chose to forget about Yosef? Those are two interesting possibilities. Vayomer elamo, and Paro said to his people, Hine am b'nei Yisrael rav atzumi menu. Behold, the people of the children of Israel are more numerous and stronger than we are. Hava nischak malo, get ready, let us deal shrewdly with it. Aya ki sikra'ena melchama, v'nosap gamhu al soninu, v'nilcham banu, v'alah min ha'aret. Get ready, let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they increase and a war befall us, and they join our enemies and depart from the land. This is the pasuk that I like to zero in on. Paro turns to his people, and he says to them, Hava nischak malo, let us outsmart them. Right? What's the shoresh of nischakma? Chacham, wise, let us outsmart them. What exactly does that mean? What was Paro's intent by using that phrase? So there's a famous Ramban. The Ramban we have looked at, I think, 3 years ago by now. I'll share with you the Ramban, particularly because it dovetails so nicely with one of the 19th century commentaries that we have not been studying all too often with our focus on 19th century commentaries. So I think it's a good opportunity to study a new Mefarash as well. So let's look at the Ramban. The Ramban writes as follows, Hava nischak malo, let us go and outsmart them. Writes the Ramban, and it's quite chilling when you think about the parallels to Nazi Germany. Lo ra'a paro v'chach me yo'atzav l'hakosam v'charet. Paro and his advisors did not think simply go around with a sword killing the Jewish people. You know, if you have an infestation of deer or some other rodent, deer is not a rodent, or some rodent that's bothering you, so the easiest way to deal with the problem is simply to kill off the animal. You have to put aside all of the animal rights activists, but you could just deal with the issue very, very easily, right? So Ravan says that's not the way Paro wanted to deal with the Jewish problem. Why? Ki tiye begida gedola. What's begida? Begida is an upheaval, like a betrayal. Yeah. It would be perceived by the masses as a terrible betrayal. La'akos chinam ha'am asher bo be'eret b'mitzas hamelech harishon. It would seem as a tremendous betrayal to start killing off the people that arrived at the invitation of the king. Long ago that Yosef, please bring your father and his family down, we'll settle them. So how can Paro, whether it's a new Paro or the same Paro who forgot about Yosef, but how can he switch so severely and start killing off the people? So the Ramban writes that Paro and his advisors knew that the way to deal with the Jewish problem is not by simply taking out a sword and killing them off. That would not have been successful. V'gam am ha'aretz lo yitnu reshus lemelech lasos chamas kazeh. The people would not give the king the green light, the authority to go ahead and be involved in such moral depravity. They wouldn't stand for that. The people of Egypt had some semblance of what's right and wrong, and they wouldn't have allowed the king to simply do such heinous things. Part number one, they were invited at the invitation of the king to live in Egypt. And number two, it's just not the right thing to do, to start killing people left and right. Ki imahem hu mityaetz. Paro sought the input from the people, and he saw that they would not have allowed for that. Va'af ki b'nei Yisrael am rav v'atzum, v'yasu imahem melchama gedola. On top of all this, the Jewish people were numerous. They weren't going to go like sheep to the slaughter, and they would have fought back. So for a whole slew of reasons, Haro understood that he's not able to deal with the Jewish problem by simply killing everybody. So that's the first level of understanding. Paro turns to his people and says, Hava nischak malo. We need to be shrewd. We need to be smart about how we go ahead implementing our solution. Because if we just take a drastic turn to start killing people, it's not going to work. So far, so good. Alan, you had a question?
Was it also against Paro's self-interest?
In what sense? Okay, well, not yet. I don't think that that's the case at this point. For all of you watching on the World Wide Web, Alan says, wasn't it beneficial to have the Jewish people enslaved in Egypt? So we didn't want to get rid of them. The answer is, I think that we're speaking about a time right now before the slavery really begun. Paro is not considering the value added of the Jewish people as slaves, because that really hasn't commenced. Okay. Okay, so good. Let's see. The Rabban makes that point, but let's look on a little bit more. Aval Amar Sheyasu Derechachma. So Paro turns to the people and says, "We need to do this in a smart way." And I italicize and I underline these words: Shelo Yargishu Yisrael Ki Be'eva Yasu Bahem. Paro wanted to move very slowly so the Jewish people should not feel that whatever it was that the Egyptians were doing was coming from a place of hatred and animosity. So we very, very slowly inch them towards servitude. So that's why the first thing that they were subject to were taxes. Kiderech hagerim ba'aretz lahalos mas sheba b'shlomo. That's normal, that people who are not citizens of the land have to pay a tax to the ruling government. So, sarei misim. What are the first things that Paro puts on the Jewish people? Sarei misim. What are sarei misim? It basically means tax collectors, that the Jewish people had to pay high taxes by virtue of the fact that they weren't naturalized citizens. They were foreigners, and they had to pay for that. Then the next step was a secret communication with the midwives that they should kill the boys while the mothers are on the birthing stools. So it was not seen to be overtly involved with murder. Various moments when the child comes out of the womb, they were given direction to kill them off, but it wasn't so clear that it was outright murder, because everybody knows that the moments of birthing are very, very dangerous moments. So if the child happened to die, more often than not, it wouldn't be seen as outright murder. Even the women who gave birth didn't understand that it was intentional murder. And then Paro has already sort of vilified the Jewish people. They're subject to great taxes. They have their children that are dying off in some epidemic, although we know it was done deliberately. But perhaps the perception from the outside is that these dirty Jews, they're unclean, their boys are dying. And at that point, Paro felt comfortable to be able to tell everybody, and then at that point Paro tells all the Egyptians, when you see a Jewish boy that's being born, throw him. The Ramban goes on to say that Yocheved wasn't able to keep Moshe around for very long, because at that point all of the Egyptians were on the lookout for baby boys trying to kill them. And as I said a few moments ago, that the parallels here between the anti-Semitism and the crushing laws that Paro instituted with the way Hitler implemented his final solution really are quite chilling. Hitler also didn't come into power And the first thing that he said was, we're going to send all the Jews to the gas chambers. The Germans were, at that point, civilized people, and I don't think that they would have allowed such a drastic turn from treating the Jew like a member of society to now going ahead and treating Jews as nothing but people that belong in the death camps. It was fast, but it was also slow, right? The first thing were the laws. The Jews can't own certain businesses. Jews' businesses had to close. Jews had to move to certain areas. It, again, happened to us. It felt very rapidly, but at least the escalation allowed for the Germans to sort of take in each step along the way, psychologically, slowly vilifying the Jewish people.
And his propaganda.
Exactly. That was all part of it. So Hitler took a play right out of Paro's playbook, unfortunately. So that is the point that I wanted to share with you from the Ramban. The Ramban actually goes on to talk about this a little bit further, but I think that we've covered our bases for the time being. I want to just bring up the biography for just a moment of the Beis Halevi, because it's just worthy of speaking for a moment or two about his biography, as it's not somebody that we usually speak about. Just give me one moment. We'll be looking at now, source number three is the Beis Halevi. So the Beis Halevi is the great-grandfather that we speak about, right? We speak about Rav Yosef Dov Halevi Soloveitchik. So Rav Soloveitchik's father was Rav Moshe Soloveitchik. Rav's grandfather was Rav Chaim Soloveitchik. And the Rav's great-grandfather was Rabbi Yosef Dov Soloveitchik, the Beis Halevi. He was born in 1820, and he died in 1892. So absolutely fitting the mark of 19th century biblical commentaries. He was a tremendous Talmud Chacham. He taught in Volozhin. He was the co-Rosh Yeshiva of Volozhin with the Netziv, Rav Naftali Tzvi Yehuda of Berlin. So we speak a lot about the Netziv in our Torah classes, in Central Biblical Commentaries. So this is a great opportunity to introduce some of the Torah from his co-Rosh Yeshiva, from the Rav that we speak about much more often. So the Beis Halevi has a very similar idea, which is really why we study the Ramban, because it segues beautifully into the Beis Halevi. So Beis Halevi says something pretty similar to the Ramban, but he also loops in a pasuk or a series of psukim from Tehillim, which I thought was really fascinating. So let's look at this inside. Right, so basically in source number three. Now, Yomer Melech Mitzrayim La'amal. Hinei, kisha'ala bedato lahara liYisrael. When it occurred to Paro that the time has come now to do evil, to do bad to the Jewish people, v'hu busha gedola lahara la'am chinam. It's terribly embarrassing for a king to make a decision to start harming a people that have done nothing wrong. Alo davar, they have done nothing wrong. There's no guilt associated with the Jewish people. And Paro understood, as the Ramban said, he can't just switch from off to on. The people weren't guilty. They were members of society like everybody else. So Paro understood that if he's going to start a campaign against the Jewish people, he had to do so shrewdly. Hava nischak malo. Let us go ahead and do something shrewdly. We have to outsmart the Jewish people, but quite frankly, who else would have to outsmart? Go from hot to cold. Al korchach hischakim lahatzia lifnei hasarim yoha rishas b'nei Yisrael. Therefore, Paro made a decision. To present some information in front of the officers, in front of the aristocrats that were alive in the time of Paro, that would speak about the evil of the Jewish people. Meaning Paro started to spread lies, slander. But he didn't just start to spread those lies amongst the plebeians. He started in the upper echelons of society. In order to let people know that the Jewish people, their heart It's not really a good heart. They're not interested in the welfare of our society. V'chi ein amun bahem. We really can't trust in them. Lo b'inyanei klal ha-medina. We can't trust in them in terms of their loyalty to Egypt. V'lo b'inyanei hanogei l'hamitzri'im b'prat. Let me reframe that. Really what the Beis Halevi says is they have no general national loyalty in general. They're not interested in being part of any particular country. And in particular, they're not interested in Egypt and in our welfare. And that's why Paro begins to give over these lies when he says, Haim am b'nei Yisrael rav v'atzum nimenu. That's going back to Pasuk Tes. Hine am b'nei Yisrael rav v'atzum mimenu. Behold, the people of the children of Israel are more numerous and stronger than we. What's embedded in that language? Writes the Beis Halevi as follows. Atzum ne'mar al k'nias nichasin umamu. Atzum, that word great, implies that they have amassed a great fortune and they have lots of resources. V'chemo ki atzamta mimenu ma'od. That's the way the pasuk is used in Bereishis. I think that's in the context of the plishtim to Yitzchak, if I'm not mistaken, that Yitzchak, you've gotten too big for us. We don't like you around us. You have too many resources. It's not good for a Jew, certainly to public resources. Our fellow citizens don't always appreciate when we're particularly successful. Okay. It could be that we were very rich, but I'm going to assume that we had no malice against the Egyptian people. We weren't interested in the downfall of Mitzrayim. The Beis Halevi, right?
19th century,
right?
Wasn't he influenced by his environment?
That's absolutely true. I think that you have to give that some thought about how that relates specifically to his commentary over here. But it's an interesting thought. Everybody's influenced by the times that they live in. But again, note that the Beis Halevi and the Ramban are very similar. So it can't be that it's purely a 19th century issue, because even the Ramban, prior so, also felt the same way. That any good host nation can't just turn overnight and start attacking those people, the visiting people who have come to live in that nation. Just give me a moment. The Amar Lahem. So Paro says, okay. Paro basically says, the Amar Lahem, Shehashirus shel Yisrael, who that the riches of the Jewish people really have come from us. They have become rich on our back. Klomar mehamitzriim. The Jews have taken our money. Al yedei shechom, turning the page. Al yedei shechomsin v'gozlim mehamitzriim. They have committed acts of theft. The word chamas is a specific word. It's different than gezel. You know, basically it uses both words, right? Chomsin Vigozlin. So gezel is theft. What's chamas? Violence. It actually, from a strictly halachic perspective, means when you force somebody to sell something, even though the seller has no interest in actually selling. So if I go over to Jeff and I give him $50 for his scarf, Jeff is not interested in parting with his scarf. I paid him for it, so could you really call it theft? Well, it's not really theft, but you didn't really want to sell. That's called chamas. That's what the word connotes. The bottom line is that it's a hostile takeover of sorts. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Eastern Semitic nation, Hittites, that come across, and in that 1200 to 1400 BC period is when the Egyptians, the flow of control from the people that could be, they may very well have been the And finally, he has that story, when you go back to Pharaoh, that he didn't even know that
right.
Joseph, and it's really possible that the son and father didn't know.
Right.
But it's an entirely different.
Very nice. So what you're saying is that there was a dramatic shift in power that would align itself scientifically, historically, with the story that so what the Beis HaLevi is saying, similar to the Ramban, right, is that Paro was very shrewd in what he was doing. He didn't think he would be successful if he would just dramatically change the attitude towards the Jews and just take out the sword and start chopping off everybody's head. That wouldn't work. So the Beis HaLevi says, Paro started basically planting these lies.
Disinformation
is a good word. Disinformation, these lies amongst the aristocrats of the Egyptian society, and then it was like a trickle down effect. If you tell your officers and the very fancy delancy people, well, sooner or later everybody knows about it. And what were the lies that Paro was giving over? Right, the lies that Paro was giving over is that the Jewish people have become rich off of our money, off of our resources, and they're involved in all sorts of unethical and unseemly practices, and that's how they've become so rich. And the last one, of course, is one that has echoed throughout all of the generations, the Notlin Ribis. What's Ribis? Interest. The Jews are the ones who are lending money and are involved in charging us very high rates of interest, usury, exactly. And that has always been part of the claims against the Jewish people, partially correctly so, because the church did not allow Christians to charge interest from one to another, from one Christian to another. So we were forced into Jew to charge interest to a Jew. It does allow Jews to charge interest to Gentiles. By the way, just as a parenthetical remark, I want to explain, the reason that we're allowed to charge to a Gentile is not because we are discriminatory against Gentiles. There's nothing wrong with charging interest at a reasonable rate. You give somebody your money to use, you can charge a rental fee for that money. That's essentially what interest is. There's nothing inherently wrong with charging interest. It's just as a Jew, to a fellow Jew, we have to see that relationship with family. So if I ask my dad for $10, he's not going to say, no problem, we'll give him back 12. You know. My dad, God bless him, won't ask me for money back altogether. But the point is that amongst family, you don't charge interest. You give somebody a loan for free. And that's the way we have to look at every relationship within the Jewish people. But to charge interest inherently is not wrong. Anyways, the Jews, unfortunately, have always been involved in this line of work. And Paro is saying, oh, you see, they're lending us money and charging interest, so on and so forth. That's why Paro says we have to think shrewdly and outsmart them. They are not faithful to our land. They are totally against our nationhood, our country. We can't rely on them. They're not going to be faithful. And therefore, we have to outsmart them and deal with the Jewish issue. Now, what's very interesting is that the Beis HaLevi says that you see this very idea echoed by David HaMelech in Tehillim. So Jeff, you need to take out the sheets right now. On the second page, we have the Hebrew and the English. This is a verse, these are really a series of verses from Sefer Tehillim. And the Beis HaLevi says what David HaMelech laments in chapter 55 of Tehillim is exactly what sought to do. David HaMelech writes, Hakshiva li va'anini, arid b'sichi ve'ahima. Hearken to me and answer me. I lament in my speech and I moan. Now, what is David moaning about? What is he lamenting about? Mikol oyev, from the voice of the enemy, mipnei akas rasha, ki amitu alai oven uva'af yistimuni. From the voice of the enemy, because it's the stress of the wicked, for they accuse me of iniquity and they hate me with a vengeance. So what's the first thing that David HaMelech is frightful over? Mipnei akas rasha, because of the distress of the wicked, ki amitu alai oven, for they accuse me of iniquity uve'af yistimuni, and they hate me with a vengeance. Right? So what's David HaMelech afraid of? The accusations. Accusations are just that, they're accusations. They're not based on reality, they're not based on facts. But David understands that the first opening for attack, the first opening for things to really go sour are those false accusations, are the lies that are spread. By the way, I'm reminded of what we discussed last week when we saw the Nitziv's interpretation for the word sitma. Remember, the brothers say, Lu yistimenu Yosef. Perhaps Yosef hates us. But recall that the word sitma, the Nitziv explains, is different than sinna. From the people who are here this week, and on all of the viewers on the World Wide Web, I can't call on you, but there are a number of people logging in right now, so you can consider yourself called upon. But what did we discuss last week? What's the difference between sinna and sitma? Right, sin has hate, but what did the brothers mean when they said Lu yistimenu Yosef? Remember, we talked about this, that sitma implies, again, a shrewd planning, right? Yosef didn't, it wasn't just like Paro couldn't kill off the Jewish people, Yosef couldn't kill off his brothers. The brothers knew that. They weren't afraid of him. Sitma means, let's say Yosef is stewing, thinking, how can I knock off my brothers in more of a
subtle way,
exactly. So that fits beautifully with the explanation over here. Because David HaMelech is saying, my enemies are going to make these accusations, uve'af yistimuni, and they hate me with a vengeance, but it's not really vengeance. They're hating me, and they're thinking, how can I be one step ahead of the Jew? That's why the word sitma is used here, because they're thinking shrewdly about how I can knock off those Jews. The next verse, Pasuk Hey, verse 5, Libi yachil bikirbi, my heart shudders within me, the emos maves naflu alai, and terrors of death have fallen upon me. Yirah v'ra'ad yachi v'atichseni palutzot, fear and trembling comes upon me, and horror comes over me, v'omar mi tenli evre kayona ufa v'esh kona, and I said, if only I had wings like a dove, I would fly away and be at rest. Essentially, basically, he's going to say that's the same feeling the Jewish people had in Egypt. It was first the concerns of the accusations, but then terrors of death have befallen. We first start with the slanders, the lies, the misinformation, and sooner or later, it really is the terrors of death that the people are afraid of. Writes the basically in source number 5, Valseder Zeh Mamish. Literally, this is the same order. Holy Chakasav and Davram and the Beis Levi quotes from this pasuk in Tehillim. Amar b'tchila ki amitu alai avon. I'm first afraid of the accusations that they will lob against me. Heim matim v'nosim alai eze avon shasisi avon u'ma'alalim alai shani ganav v'chadomer. I'm so afraid, Davram Melech says, that the my enemies are going to, again, come up with all of these accusations. They're going to accuse me of being a thief. V'chadomer davar shel haya me'olam. This is not, I didn't do any of this. Rach uva'af yistimuni. They're just going to have this vengeful hate against me. V'al kein yira'eh v'ra'ad yavo vi ve'emas mabes nafu alai. And now I am afraid and I am fearful of death that's going to befall me. The lashon yira nofel al davar shu besafik. When David HaMelech uses the word yare, I'm afraid. So Beis HaLevi says that the word yira implies that a person is not certain if the events are going to happen or not. If a person knows with certitude that the events will happen, then the word that's used is da'ad, worry out of what's going to happen. Yira implies that a person is fearful because they know what's going to happen. When a person is really afraid of what's certainly going to happen. Next paragraph. Let's say a person gets accused of stealing, and they know based on the law what will precisely happen for someone accused of stealing. In that case, lo shayach bo lashon yira. Then you wouldn't use the word yira here. The mizeh ha'onesh yafshar lo lihimalet. A person can't escape the punishment of that comes to someone for being held accountable for theft. But there's also a certain amount of safety and comfort that a person has. If you know the government follows the rules, and you know what the rules are, so if you're found guilty of stealing, you know you're not going to be executed for stealing. It might not be the word yira, it might be dag. There's a worry here, but at least you can, there's a dimension of predictability. You know what laws and what punishments will be applied. That can be applied when the ruler is not coming to create all of these false accusations against you. The person really stole, and they're being held accountable for what they did. But the Egyptians were just looking for opportunities to make these false accusations, these against the Jews. And it's really coming from a place of hatred. And that's why the feeling that David HaMelech speaks about, and perhaps he's even speaking about the experience in Egypt, or he had something very similar, it's a feeling of yira. A feeling of not knowing what's going to come next. There is no certainty whatsoever. There's no predictability. Because when the government and the ruler is out to get you, you have no guarantee of the legal process that will follow, if any will follow. And that's the feeling that David HaMelech captures in Tehillim. And that's the same exact feeling that the Jewish people had at the time when Paro was beginning to institute his version of the final solution. And that's like David HaMelech says, that if only I had wings to fly away, I would go. Because once the slander starts, it's really downhill from there. And you want to get out. That's the best option, to get out. So again, I share this with you because I think it's fascinating. The parallel between the Ramban, the Beis Halevi, that Paro understood that he's not able to simply go for the jugular. He has to go in a slow, methodical way to alienate the Jewish people. That's interesting that they both say the same thing. They focus a little bit differently in terms of implementation, right? The Ramban says that there were first taxes, and then they spoke to the midwives, and the women themselves didn't even know. And then everybody was asked to kill the babies because the Jewish people were demonized by that point. The Beis Halevi has a little bit of a different take. He focuses on the slander that Paro employed against the Jewish people, starting with the higher levels of society, and then it trickled to everybody. And eventually the Jewish people were truly alienated and were allowed to become slaves for all these years.
Isn't the Beis Halevi's interpretation more modern, reflecting what was going on at that time, as opposed to the Ramban view?
I think what makes the Beis Halevi more modern? Because of the slander as opposed to the taxes?
It's been like psychological warfare.
Right. I think the Ramban echoed those sentiments also. But the point is, he didn't do it quickly. It was methodical. It was an implementation that happened in stages. I don't know. I think we would like to assume that basically the 19th century was more sophisticated, more psychologically savvy than the Ramban, but I'm not sure that's the correct approach. I don't see a substantive difference between the Ramban and the basically. Require further analysis. Okay, let's move on now to a couple of psukim deeper into the chapter. We're at the point where either it was slander or it was taxes, but now we've moved on to sort of the second stage where Paro now turns to the midwives and he says to them, I want you to start killing the Jewish babies. In source number six, the Torah tells us, Vayomer, this is in chapter 1, verse 15 and 16, okay? Vayomer melech Mitzrayim le'meyaldos ha'ivriyos, and Paro turned to the Jewish midwives. Now, it's not entirely clear, were they actually Jewish, or were they just the midwives that were working for the Jews? It's not entirely clear from the verse. Asher shem ha'achas Shifra, v'shem ha'sheni Pua. The first one's name was Shifra, the second's name was Pua. Vayomer, and Paro says, Bialtchem es ha'ivriyos, when you're helping the Jewish women give birth, Ure Isa and Al Havnayim, and they're on the birthing stool, in Ben Hu, Bahamitenoso. If it's a boy, kill the boy. Bimbasi Bachaya, and if it's a girl, let the girl live. Now we've discussed this in past years, and I'm always I always enjoy shattering stereotypes of like biblical interpretation. That is, growing up, I think if you would ask a child in like third grade, so who were the Jewish midwives? So they would say, well, Shifra and Pua, which we know based on Rashi is Yocheved and Miriam. Okay, so we don't really think beyond that. But let's try for a moment to sort of shatter the way we're trained in grade school. It doesn't make any sense that there would be two women that would be assisting a very large nation in giving birth. Exactly, we talked about this 2 years ago. How does it practically work? Exactly, how does it practically work? So Paro turns to Shifra and Pua, and somehow that takes care of the Jewish problem? How many births do two women do over the course of a whole year? But again, we're so trained to say, oh, it's Shifra and Pua, Yocheved and Miriam, they were the ones, and because of their courage, the Jewish people, the Jewish boys were saved. How many Jewish boys could two save? Just logistically. Okay, so what? Yeah, Jeff?
Barons, the representatives.
Good, so let's,
to the Hebrew.
Very good. So let's see. So I want to show you some classic commentaries, and then we'll focus on the 19th century ones as well. So the Ibn Ezra says what things in source number 7, Vayom Melch Mitzrayim Lemialdos, Saros Hayu Al Kol Hamialdos. What does that mean? These two women were in charge over all of the women that assisted in childbirth. These were not the women who were literally delivering every boy and girl for the Jewish people. It's impossible. It's impossible. Right? The Rashi tells us in the beginning of say Bereshis that every birth had six babies. It was like we were just popping them out. So it's impossible for two women to deal with that. So Ibn Ezra says that these two women were in charge. They were an officer. They were the ones in charge over all of the midwives that were assisting the Jewish people. He ain't suffate ki yosef meos miados hayu. There had to have been at least 500 of these midwives. Ella elu shtehen saros hayu alehen. These two women were in charge of the 500. Lates mas lemelech mehaschar. What was the point? Why do you need people in charge? Because they had to pay taxes. Who was going to collect the income tax? It was clearly a very profitable business to be in, to assist women in giving birth. It was happening every day, six times for every woman. So Paro wanted to get in on some of that action. So he made the women pay income tax. It's nothing new. Before it was Uncle Sam, it was Uncle Paro. And so these two women, their job was to go around collecting the tax. So he asked them to communicate this message. And even as it says, V'kachar isi hayom b'mekomos rabos. This is what's generally done. I'm not sure if he's referring to the fact that there's income tax that's taken, or if he's referring to the fact that there are women in charge of other women. There's a sort of a hierarchy of the structure in the business. One way or the other, it was obvious to the Ibn Ezra. And it has to be obvious to us that they had some sort of system. Paro communicated with the ladies that he that directly report to him, and they had to pass it along to all their channels. If it's a baby boy, kill the baby boy.
What is the account of Jews that Paro
rescued Jews? So the question is, were they really Jewish? You're right, Alan. If they were Jewish, it really doesn't make a lot of sense to suggest that they were the ones that were asked to kill off their own type. Paro was clearly a shrewd man, having a sakh malo. It wouldn't make sense for him to tell the Jewish women themselves to kill their own children. You could say that when the Torah tells us the Mialdos HaIvrios, it doesn't mean that they themselves were Jewish. It means that they were the ones in charge of the Jewish people. That's an equally as valid read. Not the way Rashi spins it. Rashi says that they were Yocheved and Miriam. We'll come back to that, but that is, it's certainly a very reasonable understanding of those words. Layomer Melch Mitzrayim La Mialdos HaIvrios. That Paro turned to the one in charge of birthing for the Jewish people. Judy.
I was looking at the way the wording is spelled.
What do you make of that difference? Does the vav itself? Does the vav indicate that? I'm not 100%. It's not uncommon for the Torah to have one word spelled malay with a vav and one word spelled chaser without a vav. I'm not certain that all of those times necessarily have a reason. And even if the vav was there, I don't know if that indicates the, you know, the sort of the possessive, like it's the Jewish people themselves. That I agree with you. It's logically impossible to say that these two women were in charge of everything. Right. Agreed. Alan, were you going to say something? Okay, so let's look at the Nitziv. The Nitziv echoes the comment of Ibn Ezra. The Nitziv writes in source number 8, Lafi Hakshat Shehein, and according to the simple understanding that Shifra and Pua are the names of the women. So al korchach lo hina bilvad hayu miyaldos. You can't tell me that these were the only two women of the entire Jewish people. B'chol Yisrael asher garu b'kam ha'arim. The Jewish people spread out in multiple cities. It's just impossible. Ela hein hayu hamiyaldos haroshios. They were in the rosh. What does rosh mean? They were the heads. The same language that Ibn Ezra uses sar, that in the Tzid uses the word rosh. They were the heads of the midwives. Alpi pikudas paro alehen, or probably Galpihen, pikudos paro alehen. It's through them Paro communicated his orders. Yitzavu l'chol hamiyaldos asher tachtehen. Through communicating to the women on top, Paro communicated to everyone, all the lower level employees as well. And so I just wanted to show you that the Ibn Ezra and the Nitziv say the same thing, even though, again, they are centuries apart from one another. It begs the question if the Nitziv saw the Ibn Ezra's commentary. So if he did, then why did he need to say the same thing? I don't know. I'm not sure. I don't know. But assuming that he did, then why did he just say the same thing that the Ibn Ezra said? I'm not sure. Okay, let's look at the Malbim, another fantastic 19th century German Torah commentary, for a different interpretation entirely. Because so far what we're saying is that Ibn Ezra and the Nitziv suggest that these are not two women, Shifra and Pua, but they were not the only ones involved in the job, but they were just the ones in charge, and they communicated with all of their employees. The Malbim says something entirely different, very creative, in source number 9. Vayomer Melech Mitzrayim. So Kfi Hapshat Amar Laha Mitzrios Shehayu Miyaldos Es Haivrios. So first of all, Judy, I don't know if he's focusing on the vav, but clearly, and really I should have said Alan, because you're the one that made the point, but according to the Malbim, they were Egyptian. They were not Jewish women. Kfi Hapshat Amar Laha Mitzrios Shehayu Miyaldos Es Haivrios. According to simple understanding, Paro turned to the Egyptian midwives who were in charge of the Jewish women. Again, Alan, just to echo what you said, it makes a lot more sense. Because why would Paro turn to one of their own to execute the baby? It doesn't make sense. It makes sense is that there was just like we go to Holy Name Hospital and we go to Inglewood Hospital and we go to, I have to be careful what I say, because Mount Sinai wouldn't be a good example. Or Cedar Sinai in Los Angeles wouldn't be a good example. But we go to all sorts of secular hospitals, okay, and we get treated, Baruch Hashem, like everybody else. So the point is, the mom says that there were these the Egyptian midwives, and they helped the Jewish women give birth. So how do we, there's two of them. So says the mom something really interesting. V'haya shnei mine miyados. There are two types of midwives. It's not two people. It's not that they were the ones on top and then Paru is going to just send the orders through them. That's not the way the Malbim explains it. The Malbim says that they were two types of women that were involved in this area of employment. Echad, number one, Shehaisa Osekes Im Hayosheves Al HaNashder Lohotzi Avad. The first woman, her job was to assist the woman who was sitting on the birthing stool and giving birth. V'hasheni Shehaisa Osekes Im HaNolad. The second woman was in charge of taking the baby, Lichros Tiburo, to cut off the umbilical cord, and to help the baby with all that he needs. Ha'achas nikre shifra. The first one was called Shifra. V'hashen is Pua. The second one was Pua. Meaning these are not two women. They're not the CEOs of midwifery incorporated in Egypt. These were just two jobs. There was the first job was to assist the woman giving birth. The second job was to help with the baby. V'kachai ara yom hazeh, right? Baruch Hashem. For all of us who've been zochet to be in a labor and delivery room, there's not just one woman that comes, right? Obviously, the doctor's calling the shots. The doctor is focused on the woman giving birth. You have a whole group of nurses. One is helping the doctor with the lady. The other is going to take the baby, and so on and so forth. It requires a whole team. That's what the Malbim is saying. Shifra and Pur, two jobs. It's beautiful. It's very creative. It makes a lot of sense. The ein perusho shlo hayu rak shtei miyaldos daha. Hayu Amrav, the rock wrote Salom, Rashne, Mine Mialdos. Again, don't tell me there were two ladies. There were two jobs. And Paro tells both of those types of people working those jobs, meaning if you're a Shifra lady or a Pua lady, Paro says to both then, one way or the other, you got to kill the baby boy if it's born from a Jewish lady. That's what Paro is communicating. So brilliant, right? Brilliant insight of the Malbim. It's not two names of women. It's two names within the general midwifery profession. Fantastic. Okay. Yes, so they do. Other commentaries focus on that. So, for example, the Kliyakar connects Shifran Pua to Yocheved and Miriam. I wasn't. All right, well, why don't we do that? I'll do that. To answer your question, Jeff, the Malbim doesn't say what the connection is between Shifra and Pua. The Malbim himself does not explain like why one job is associated with one task and why the other name is associated with the other task. The Malbim does not give that level of detail. Other commentaries do. If you look at Rashi, for example, in source number 10, Shifra, Zu Yocheved, Hashem Shemisha Feres Es Havlad. Rashi says the word Shifra is connected to like Shifra, which is pretty pleasant. So it was Yocheved, Moshe's mom, and she received the name Shifra because she made the baby look like pleasant. Yeah, to wipe off all the gook and so on and so forth. Okay, Pua, Zu Miriam. Rashi says that's Miriam. Shepoa umidaberes vehoga livlad kiderech hanashim hamifaisos tino kabocha. Pua is like pa pa pa. It's like an alliteration of sorts. That Miriam would like quiet down the baby, like when you're trying to calm down a screaming baby, you go shh, shh, you move your lips to try to quiet down the baby. Okay, so Rashi does not tie it back to those two tasks that the Malbim does. It's not that Rashi says, well, one was attentive to the woman giving birth and the other was. Rashi's trying to explain why the Torah uses words other than the actual names of the women. Miriam and Yocheved, Yocheved is called. Miriam is called Pua. The question is, the Kliyakar deals with in source number 11, we're not going to read inside, but it's a Gishmak Kliyakar. The Kliyakar says, okay, I understand two Egyptian names, Shifra and Pua, and we want to connect them to Miriam and Yocheved. But why does Rashi pick that Yocheved is Shifra and Miriam is Pua? Why doesn't Rashi say Shifra is Miriam and Pua is Yocheved? Why does Rashi connect the ladies to these particular? So the Kliyakar says something really beautiful. He says as follows, Shifra, again, is beauty, is like beauty. And we know that Yocheved was an older woman, but she returned back to her youthful beauty when her husband returned to her and they gave birth to Moshe. So we know that Yocheved is associated with beauty because she was beautiful when she was 130 when she gave birth to Moshe. So that's why Rashi specifically connects Shifra to Yocheved, because Yocheved herself became beautiful again later in life. And Pua, So who was associated with the mouth, with speaking? Miriam was a prophetess. We know that she provided much inspiration for the Jewish people. She led the women through the sea, right? Vatam lahem Miriam, Ashir Lashem, so on and so forth. So if we have one job that's associated with the mouth, which lady deserves that connection? Miriam. Because Miriam is the one who prophesies with her mouth. So it's a very interesting and creative interpretation of the Kliyakar. Okay, the hour is late. Let's try to look at one last interpretation of another 19th century biblical commentary. We'll look at Rav Hirsch. So if you look in source number 12, this is the very next verse. So again, we saw in source number, just one moment. We looked in source number 6, we looked at verses 15 and 16, where Paro gives the orders that if it is a baby boy, you gotta kill that baby boy as the mother is giving birth. So do these women listen? The answer is no, they don't. In source number 12, Vatir Ena Hamialdos Es Alokim, the midwives, however, fear God. Parenthetically, how much more impressive is it if you take the Malbim's approach that these women were not Jewish? It's even more impressive. It was not their own family, and they still stood up for what's right. And that also reinforces to us the strength of the Ramban and the Beis Halevi. People in Egypt did have a moral code. They did have a sense of what's right and what's wrong. So if you understand that these midwives were not Jewish, and they still feared God, there was a sense of a moral value system. So we understand even more why Paro had to think very, very shrewdly. How can I outsmart even my own people? They're not going to go for outright murder. And in fact, we see that the midwives don't.
But he made a mistake.
What do you mean? Well, in this case, he did miss it. And that's what Rav Hirsch is going to write. Let's look at source number 12 again, the Pasuk. This is chapter 1, verse 17. Vatirena hamialdos es Elokim, v'lo asu kashir divir aleihen melech Mitzrayim, and he did not do as they were told from the king of Egypt. But they enabled the boys to live. So Rav Hirsch writes very beautifully in source number 13 as follows. Vatichayena es hayiladim means lo zu bilvad shelo asu kimitzas hamelech. It's not simply that they turned the other cheek and they looked away when a baby boy came out of the womb. Ela asu kimitav yicholtzan lishmor al chayei hayiladim. The word vatichayena means not let them live. Vatichayena implies more of an active participation. They brought the children to life. It's not simply that they turned away and let the mother deal with her infant young boy. They were actively involved in sustaining life in those first moments. They were proud participants of the birthing experience. And that just goes to show you how Paro was wrong. He thought they would kill. Not only did they not kill, they not only did they just let it be, you know, shave al passive, not to, they weren't just passive, they were active participants. Vatichayena. They brought the children to life. Kol ma'amatzav shel hamelech hesigu totzot hafuchos. All of what the king desired became ultimately the opposite. Meaning, with all of the oomph that Paro put into telling the midwives to kill the baby boys, with that exact oomph, in the opposite, it was used for the positive, that the midwives were involved in bringing the children to life. Kimi'ata nidrushu hamiyaldos, biyosa nos, they were straight, God-fearing women, v'ishtada b'kolkochan v'lip'ol l'fi meitav klali amunasan. They could, based on their belief system, l'chroa berech l'ischanin al Hashem, they sort of bowed down and began diving to God, that they were hoping, they offered a prayer. God, don't let this child be a stillbirth. Because the midwives were concerned that if the child would start dying, they would lose their job. No one would call them. Right? You don't think that if after a couple of times the midwife kills the baby, that no other Jewish woman is going to kill, you know, call that woman? They lose their job. They were afraid that rumors would start going around that they were not doing a good job of helping the women give birth. So you get the sense from a person that they were active participants in bringing about the health of the child. They would daven to Hashem that the child should be healthy, that the birth should go well. So everything that Paro was hoping for, the opposite for the good, took place.
What is he saying? Is he saying that the women were acting in their own self-interest, or they were fearful of God?
It seems like it was both. It was both. They were afraid that they would have a reputation that would not be a good one if they started to be associated with stillbirth and babies that didn't make it. But it also seems from Rapersh and just the psukim that they had a moral code that they lived by, and they understood that it was wrong to kill a baby, no matter what. And that propelled them to do all that they could possible in order to bring life to the children. I mean, there's so much more to be said, but let us stop over here. Thank you for everybody who has joined us on our live stream, and we will continue Mirat Hashem next week with Parshas Va'era.